Thank you, Honorable Sir, for giving me this opportunity to discuss this very, very important topic that is plaguing the world today. I stand here as a member of All India Trinamool Congress. We are actually standing at crossroads today, to be or not to be. To be a developed nation or not to be. Certain nations have been developing at a faster pace than ours over the last centuries. And they have also been major contributors towards the greenhouse gas emission. Their carbon footprint has also been much more than ours. When we take up the task of development, a lot of sanctions and interjections are being placed before us, and we as a developing nation are facing this problem now. So as my Honorable Chief Minister Srimati Mamata Banerjee has rightly pointed out, that with perspective to India, the NGT has to be prudent in their restriction towards our development projects and refrain from overzealous actions. But I take this opportune moment to extend gratitude to the world leaders of 193 countries who, during the General Assembly of the United Nations in September 2015, got together and took serious cognizance of this burning issue to strike a balance between growth, development of the nations, of individuals, and also to maintain nature, environment, protect our planet. Five P's are involved in this total effort: people, planet, peace, prosperity, and partnership between nations. The Sustainable Development Goals were worked up on the Millennium Development Goals. 8 number of them were there, and we have done quite well. And depending on that, we have worked upon the SDGs, which also involves the environment. The MDGs did not take into cognizance the environmental factor, but here we want to maintain the environment. Like all of us were born from one mother, we have only one world. And to leave this world for our posterity, we must protect the world. Even if we are trying to develop in different fields, we have to take care of our planet, of our atmosphere, of our water bodies, of our nature. And the SDGs has taken into consideration, and this is the first time that all the nations first got together, discussed, and then formulated the 17 goals and 169 targets that we are going to undertake over the next 14 years up to 2030 to meet our needs. It has already come into effect from 1st of January this year. And unlike many previous decisions, the world together in consultation has drawn this up. It was not due to any regional decision. It was not due to any national decision. It was rather a quantitative decision dealing not only with human or the planet separately. Ecological sustainability was seen as an element of economic development. The problems were taken to be universal, interconnected, because the air quality getting disturbed over my country will go and affect another country. But in doing so, we also have to take into consideration that we are growing, we are developing, and we must be given more opportunity. The first 6 goals for MDG, which were for poverty alleviation, has been repeated here also. We, the developing world, need industrialization, but we have to be protective towards Mother Earth. On behalf of the people we served, we have adopted a historic decision on a comprehensive, far-reaching, and people-centered set of universal and transformative goals. We are committed in achieving sustainable development in these 3 dimensions of economic, social, and environmental development to build upon the MDGs. But most important would be policy making. When we are discussing it here today, budget allocation would be made, should be made towards meeting these 17 goals and 169 targets. And we have to strike a balance. The developed world has been a major contributor towards polluting our water bodies, our air quality, about depletion of forests, about starting the practice of newer food techniques, and we have followed suit. We have forgotten our traditional foods. Yesterday, Honorable Speaker had organized a meeting regarding SDGs, and there an honorable member was pointing out regarding the present situation in which the present generation doesn't even recognize traditional foods like jowar, bajra for nutrition. We are depending upon packed foods. Preparing foods in the factories, packing them, marketing them involves a lot of artificial methods and energy expenditure, which is not good for the planet. We have to go back to our natural resources. 6 of the goals here, out of the 17, they relate directly to disaster risk reduction, recognizing that reducing exposure and vulnerability of the poor to disasters is essential for sustainable poverty eradication. Out of the 17, the first one is poverty eradication. Poverty and a degraded environment are closely interrelated, especially where people depend for their livelihoods primarily on the natural resource base for their immediate environment. Restoring natural systems and improving natural resource management practices at the grassroots level to protect nature are the central to a strategy to eliminate poverty. Diversion of common and marginal lands to more economically viable, as we say today, useful purposes deprives the poor of a resource base which has traditionally met many of their sustenance needs. Like the right of the forest should be with the people who live in the forest since ages unknown. We should give the power to live in the forest, use the forest as their own, to the Adivasis who've been living there, the tribals who've been living there. Instead of cutting the trees and giving away the wealth of the forest, giving away the mines and the minerals in the forests to multinationals. Market forces also lead to the elimination of crops that have traditionally been integral to the diet of the poor. Here I would like to point out that these days baby food and prepared food is taking a serious toll on the health of the children. If the babies are breastfed, they are saved, they are protected from reproductive tract diseases, they are protected from diarrheal diseases, and it is known that according to a very important study in the Medical Journal of Lancet, breastfeeding could save 8,20,000 lives annually, preventing 13% of all deaths of children under 5. Breastfeeding could reduce 1/3 of the respiratory infections. For India, it could reduce 1,56,000 child deaths each year. It would reduce maternal deaths of cancer. Breastfeeding forms a natural contraceptive towards maintaining family size. And it would also help the lady not to get breast cancer or that of the reproductive tracts. 4,300 crores improve as far as the IQ of the child is concerned, the child who's breastfed. Not only that, the proprietary preparations that are marketed by different companies at the moment, they sell milk formulas which emit 1,11,226 tons of greenhouse gases. So many countries are opting and educating the mothers towards breastfeeding. United Nations is laying a stress on infant and young children feed. There are reports that many children who have been fed on formula milk, they remain stunted in growth, in chronic hunger, and their IQ is not optimally developed. Not only that, due to the greenhouse emission during preparation, it generates carbon footprints. The industrially manufactured milk formula adds greenhouse gases emission at every step of production, transport and use, and it gives rise to wastage also. One of the sustainable development goals, the second one, is regarding the food that the developed nation throws away, but the underdeveloped nation goes hungry. There are many of people in the underdeveloped nations. To be specific, one in every 9 children go to bed hungry. But every day, the food wasted in the developed nation is 4,896 crore kilograms. These food materials that are used for landfills give rise to methane gas. This methane again causes global warming. And this food waste is in the United States at its highest, where about 80% of the people who are throwing the food say that they feel guilty while throwing the food on their plate, but they cannot help it. I think while we are discussing the SDG, we are here to draw policies, how we can work towards attaining the SDGs. The policy should not to throw food. We should actually make it a stylish slogan in the society. There should be a slogan, grow more food, don't throw food. Each one of us should try to grow a little bit of what we eat. I can proudly say that I don't buy vegetables for my family, I grow it myself. Everybody might not be having land to grow enough for the whole family, but every balcony, every rooftop can house pots, earthenware pots, where not only you grow your own vegetables in little amount, but where you can actually make manure or compost from everyday household waste, like vegetable peels and wasted food matter. It can be just turned into compost and used as manure. So the slogan should be, you can have pots in your balconies where you can have your waste product turned into manure, and you can have little amount of vegetables grown. So the slogan should be, grow food, don't throw food. Not only for India, it should be globally accepted. Everyone must grow a little bit to contribute to the nation, to the international community, to the planet. And we have to take into consideration that a major thrust at the policy level is necessary to ensure equity and justice for us, for everybody. Then the next SDG is the basic education. I am proud to say that my leader, Srimati Mamata Banerjee, Chief Minister, Honorable Chief Minister of West Bengal, she started the Kanya Shri, in which she has allotted 1,500 crores, not a paltry 100 or 1,000 crores, and 25 lakhs girl children are being empowered. And she is giving them non-polluting vehicles in the form of cycles to pedal to school. Because these pedaling of cycle is not only allowing the girl to go safely to the school and come back, but the very effort of pedaling the cycle is creating a proper cardiac output by which she will never get hypertensive, she will never get diabetic, she will never have a heart attack when she grows up. So this is the foresight of my leader, Srimati Mamata Banerjee. I think we should all accept and adapt these methods towards sustainable development, because a cycle is a non-polluting vehicle. With perspective to India, 15% of homes are lit by kerosene. As far as industry is concerned, we are using fossil fuel. As far as production of electricity is concerned, we are using fossil fuel. And even for lighting of homes, we are using kerosene. It is a polluting agent. It is disturbing the atmosphere. So we have to shift towards renewable and clean energy. But my personal experience is, I have allocated a lot of money from the members' local area development fund towards street lighting by solar. But after 2 to 3 years, there is no after-sales service. There is nobody to take care of the batteries. So once they stop working, there is nowhere by which we can take them forward. The present government has started the Pradhan Mantri Kushal Yojana, in which vocational training is being given to young children, young dropouts. I would request the government to train these young students to maintain the sources of renewable energy, the equipments of renewable energy and non-polluting equipments, so that they become a good workforce and maintain these renewable energy equipments for use for a very long time. With increasing purchasing power, wasteful consumption linked to market-driven consumerism is stressing the resource base of developing countries. So we should go back to our traditional way of living in the fashion as our father of the nation had taught us, for simple living. We have to realize whether this is technology push or market pull that the nations today are responding to, the newer generation is responding to. If it is only the technology push, then dialogue through policy making would have to be started with the multinationals who are forcing our youth to follow paths which are forcing them to buy these equipments which are polluting. Out of these different SDG goals, agriculture is another very important because it involves land use and water use. We should make available water for agriculture even to the remotest villages. We should start practicing multi-crop agriculture and have a proper land use policy, and depletion of land should be taken care of by scientists who can ensure nitrogen fixation by alternating crops through leguminous crops. Not only will it bring down the price of dal as it is now, but the legumes will also stabilize the nitrogen of the soil. The biomass, which will continue for a long time to be a major source of fuel energy, especially for rural poor, we have not actually been able to help them. Biomass will form their major source. But there are two kinds of biomass usage for combustion. The cow dung cake is polluting, and it is also increasing in price at the moment. But the gobar gas is not. That should be made universally available to the rural poor. The significance of the diversity in nature must be realized, must be appreciated and taught in schools, because we need to protect, preserve only one earth we've got, and there is a strong relationship between health and the state of environment and employment, because the workers of asbestos, silicon and mines, they get silicosis. They are dying of lung diseases. So we have to give them a proper healthy atmosphere to work and earn living. The overseas development assistance is declining, and the commitments made by industrialized countries in the Earth Summit a decade ago is mostly unmet. We have to turn our attention towards that. Environmental and social clauses, which are implicitly or explicitly part of international agreements, must not be used selectively to to erect trade barriers against us. We have to take this up at international fora. Mechanism must be put in place to make available to developing countries, that is us, the latest technology at reasonable cost. And the mainstream education should include science, and children should be taught basic science so that they know about the future. If they do not preserve this earth, they have no more. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.